Hey all, it's David Fuchsia, and this is Endless Space Disharmony. This is a 4X game that's very similar to Total War and Civilization, except that it's set in space, and you're basically a spacefaring nation that is out to achieve dominance over the galaxy. We'll start a new game here, and I'll give you a little bit of a rundown of what it's all about. We're going to set the medium here. Let's go for like a spiral galaxy, go with spiral 8, and actually go with spiral 4. We'll set down the empires to like 5, and if I want to I can set the age of the universe so that we have different types of planets. Make it random just for the lols, I guess. We'll keep the difficulty normal, the game see if it's going to be normal, and I'm going to go Amoeba. Just to sort of demonstrate what this game is all about. There's multiple, by the way, empires you can choose from in Endless Space. You have, of course, you know, your combat-oriented type of, you know, empires that, like, trying to kill all the other empires. You have your, you know, science-faring types of empires. You have your isolationist empires, just so I don't want to be left alone. You have your sort of builder empires, that just sort of like try and dominate and make wonders in the galaxy. And then there's like just these roundabout empires that just sort of can do whatever they want. And all these empires, they play different later. It's not like Civilization 5 where you could play the Babylonians or the Polish all in one certain type of way if you want to. You're pretty much set into playing your militaristically if you pick a militaristic race. Or you're going to be going, like, you know, scientific if you're going with a science race and all that. But anyway, so we'll go with Amoeba. Amoeba are isolationist trading type of empire, but they have this very good affinity that will let me just demonstrate something. Basically, they start with a whole map known. Kind of like, a, you know, how in the old Civilization 2 games you had a little cheat. You could see the entire map, everything on it. Amoeba are sort of like that. Not entirely like that, but they sort of have it. I'll just basically jump in, and we'll just get underway, and I'll just show you what I'm talking about here. Yes, loading screens. So yeah, all the races have their sort of like background type of things. There's a tutorial if you need it. We'll skip the tutorial. Blah blah blah, confirm. Alright, so this is our starting system. Depending on the race you pick, you might have different Terran planets that you jump on. In this case, we started on a medium ocean planet because the Amoeba start always on an ocean planet. There can be other, you know, starting things that might happen depending on what race you pay. If, for example, you go with the automatons, you'll have like a sort of, you know, they'll have like this sort of planet anomaly that's going to be negative effect, sort of a negative effect that will sort of hurt you initially. But for Amoeba, we're on this colonized ocean planet, and we'll be going from there. We have ships to start off with, much like in Civilization 5. Those include, I'll just go into the military screen here. Those include like an explorer, you know, one to scout around a little bit, and a settler type, which in this case is a propagator. And something I noticed that each of the empires will have different names for their ships. So for like the United Earth, or United Empire that's like based off of Earth, they'll have transports, which are like their settlers, and they'll have scout ships that are, I believe it's called scouts. Anyhow, for starting here, we'll just get going. I want to click on you. We'll go with the scout, and we're gonna just look around in a bit. Actually, I'll just do this first. Whee! So yes, you can zoom out. And this is our galaxy with all the many stars in it. If we zoom in a little bit, you'll see all the different places. Because we're Amoeba, we get to see everything in here. Unlike the other races, the Amoeba are able to see everything in the beginning, and you can also zoom in to find out who your enemies are gonna be. So in this case, you got a Horatio over here. I can tell because they got a big area of influence to start off with. Over here is another Horatio. Down here, Electra, there is an automaton player. Over here, nearest to us, is the Sophons. They're the scientific guys, and the rest are just, you know, waiting to be colonized planets. Alright, so one of the nice things as well is that I get to see the empires and what's in them. So in this case, we got a Terran planet over here with a bunch of lava plants nearby. In Ying, there's a large baron and a large gas plant. Those will be, you know, meh, don't really care about them. Over here in Pegasus, there's a desert plant, a barren trap, and well, look at all this. There's negative anomaly, negative anomaly, negative anomaly. These are all bad things, these red anomalies down here. So on top of the fact that these are all later class plants, it's just a lot of trouble to try and even settle in this one, so we won't worry about that. Over here, and I'll actually note something. Depending on the star system, you can actually guess what type of plants you'll be settling. So in this case, we got yellow suns over here, much like our own. That's a white star, I think, over there. There's a pulsating star. Down here, we've got like a blue star plant. Another white star plant over here. And these all depend on all determine what type of planets you can suspect to be in the place. A red is a dying star over here, and they'll have cooler planets. If I click on this yellow star planet here, I'll have like, you know, a colonizable planet, some other stuff. That's a really good one right there. That's kind of far though. This one that's nearby is just a quick jungle plant, not too bad. Alright, this is a really nice plant to look into. I'll probably want to grab that pretty quick, because it's right next to this guy down here, sort of the Sophon. This guy's going to be branching out pretty quick too, so I want to, you know, grab what I can. Something to note is that because I'm an Amoeba, I can actually see what I want to colonize. And this is one of the advantages for this empire. Each empire has their own advantage to start off with. These guys, they'll research really fast and have really good technologies. They have fast ships, so they can dart around and colonize stuff as close by as they find it. The Horatio, if I go over to them, as you can see, they have a big influence. They can populate quite well, and they can clone their heroes if they so wish. Over here, the automatons, they're sort of like a rebellious anarchist type of state. They kind of suffer in sort of organization, but they make up for it in sort of like late term type of building. Because something to note, unlike in civilization where you basically want to be building something every single turn, you don't have to build in anything in endless space for a turn if you want to, and it'll actually stack that industry for next turn or the turns after. So it's really cool how they can do that. I'm actually sort of taking a long time, sort of running about exploring. Let's just actually start exploring here. I like this plant here. I think because it's like a Terran. I like this one down here because it's, you know, a lot of good plants. Wasasis is a nice little grab it and be happy with it. Columba is really, really close to the Sophons, but okay, I don't care about that. Is this close to the Sophons? I don't care about it. There might be resources on these planets, but I'm not going to worry about that either. There's wormholes. These determine where you can go. Early on, wormholes basically prevent travel until you get technology that lets you traverse them. To be honest, I didn't get really good plants when I jumped in here, but that's not too bad. I'm not gonna be playing this game too long, to be honest. Now, being Amoeba, I don't have to explore, but it's good to pretty much explore because there could be pirates. They don't start spawning right away, but you know, just something to throw out there. There is pirates. I want to grab Oceus right off the bat, so we'll send our colonizer down this direction. And covering the stars, so you've mapped up half the, because you're Amoeba, you get to see everything, so not really much of an achievement there. Well, since all this, these are heroes, by the way. And I'll actually jump into that, I guess, right now. So heroes are kind of like, little guys that you can recruit to sort of make your systems better. In this case, we've got, I believe, two Horatios, and this guy is what? A Sophon, perhaps? Famous for objective analysis on factored data, blah, blah, blah. She's an administrator and a corporate, so she's really good for like managing your system. She'll probably be like one of the first hero I want to upgrade. You always want to get a hero, by the way. They really help you quite a bit. These Horatios, this guy's a pilot, an adventurer. He's like a defensive invader type of character, I guess. This guy here, he's pilot adventurer. He's another. Oh, he's an invader right there. You can tell these attributes determine what the heroes can do. Labor is good for like production and food. Wit is good for science and dust. Lee's all about invading and defending like star systems, you know, as they're under attack. Offense and defense are all about fighting. One, you know, is about defense, one's about offense. Pretty much not, you know, it could be the same thing for all that matters. I want to go into Empire here. Much like in the older games, you have a tax rate, which you can, you know, morph around. So in like, I think like Civilization 2 is sort of how it works. You can like have like, you know, no dust output or lots of dust output. Early on, it's probably good to have a little bit of dust output to get a hero, but you don't want to have it going, you know, to the point where you're unhappy. So we'll go like this and we'll get like two, and that'll be good enough for now. Having enough content is fine. Hopefully I'll get little, you know, enough dust to get the hero right away, but I'm not going to worry about getting it real too quick. There is research, and early on we want to get Amoeba fusion plants for the star system improvement, heavy iso refineries. These are like your forge or your factory type of thing you get right off the bat. So we'll get that right away. And research stacks too, so you don't have to worry about, you know, waste of research. You can just put into the next research as you go along. You can just sort of hang out here. We'll have you just sort of intercept and make sure no one invades me. Gotta get those enemy fleets out of here if they pop around. I could also make them wait, or the fleet to remain idle until the enemy's in the fleet's range. That might be a better idea in case, you know, a scout like pops out. I don't want him running around and, you know, going to war right away, because that's not my way as an Amoeba. You can end turn, and we'll do that. So it's a new turn. This thing just makes you move your ships as necessary, so we'll move him a little bit further. As you can see, I got two dust, which is your currency. And I'll, you know, get some more dust next time. I should probably note that I forgot to do something. In these individual plants, you can change their exploitation so they can do different things. What I could do is I can make it so I get some food production, which will make it grow faster. I could also go with industry for production, science for science, dust for dust. It, you know, all depends on what the plant's offering. After that, you know, there's other stuff over here that I could get. We'll actually wait until I get this first, and then we'll probably get our factory type of improvements going on. We'll keep going for a little bit more. And we made our settler type of ship get all the way to Oshii. So Oshii's got, you know, a jungle, which is something you can colonize right from the get-go. You don't have to research anything. You can colonize tundra and arid planets, and you can even colonize gas plants and barren plants, but it takes a long time before you want to do that. And this gang is like jungle right off the bat. That's really cool. So we'll like grab Oshii and be happy. So colonize, and we'll go with the teeny jungle because, you know, it's cool. So now I own that. Great things have great beginnings, or small beginnings. Much like with the other one, I want, you know, choose an exploitation. We'll go with farming so it builds up faster. And I'm actually going to go into research here. You can actually plan your research so that, you know, you like grab whatever you want to, and I'll actually go on a little bit about research. There's four tech trees to choose from at any given time. So unlike Civilization, where you like, you know, you have like a long tree that goes all the way from ancient era to Renaissance era or industrial era or whatever else era, you only have four different trees at any given time, and they're all focused on different things. One's like military, galactic warfare. One's the diplomacy and trading technology tree. One's science and, you know, applied sciences, and the other ones here is like exploration and expansion. And they all do different things. You know, Galactus, you know, war. The diplomacy and trade, that's all about, well, food production, coinage, happiness. That's all the stuff over here. You also have all your diplomatic stuff over here, like ceasefire, offer peace. That's something you eventually can, you know, find if you want to, much like in the old Civilization 3 games where you get, I think, writing and you can declare peace treaties and all that with that. Over here in the applied sciences, you have your more tech tree type of stuff, so production, sciences, and you also have several fleet options too. So applied sciences, you know, like how the Greeks are, they sort of had applied sciences and, like, you know, they're developing their phalanxes and all that. It's sort of the same with how applied sciences works in this game. So you have to, like, I'll get into this basically, but in fleet combat, your units can have different sort of things to, like, you know, tactics, offensive retreat. I can, like, retreat while firing, basically. I could have, like, down here, where is it? There's other stuff that I could possibly get. There's one, energy or absorption. So this is like a sort of defensive technique that lets me basically improve the efficiency of my shields, but it hurts my sort of deflectors, I guess. Galactic warfare is fairly easy to explain. It's basically all your weapons, all your defensive stuff. That's where you go for your military. Exploration, that's a little bit more difficult to explain. Basically, exploration lets you colonize stuff. So here's like colonized tundra, that's where you can do that. You also get your ship designs from down here. So if I want to have, like, you know, the bigger, better ships, you have to go down this tree for them. And there's other stuff too, like, as I said, wormholes, you need the technology for it. Here it is, unlock space travel via wormholes. So we reach down here, lets you get elsewhere in the game. There's also a couple other things like Moon Survey. You'll learn about that later in the game. I was going to, like, just research. We'll do that right now. We'll go with, I guess, Tundra. Oops. Tundra, and then we'll go Arid. We'll go in that direction just to get those out of the way because, you know, I want to grab Tundra for this and Arid for that when I get the chance. They're good plants to colonize. It won't let me colonize any of those plants. It won't let me colonize any of these plants. I don't think there's any Arid or Tundra plants besides those two. There might be some down here. No, there might be. Let's just look around. There's a couple of Tundra. So down here, next to the Sylphons, there's a nice plant that's got Tundra stuff in them. Down here, there's a bit of Arid. That's his jungle over there. Nothing good there. And that's my plant over there. Over here on the other side of the wormhole, when I get around to it, we'll have Tundra. So there's a, you know, I wouldn't be able to colonize in this system unless I had Tundra after a few turns. Though, I'm not sure. Well, that's actually worth it for this blue cap mold. That's a sort of luxury resource. Yes, luxury resources in this game. And they work much like the Civilization game where they increase your population happiness. Ugh, my nose. Alright, well, I'm sort of building up dust. That's what I'm pretty much aiming to do at this point. So we'll keep doing that. We have to wait a few turns here. And I produced resource exploitation. What happened is I researched Amoeba fusion plants. This also gives me the ability to see titanium 70. That's a strategic resource, much like iron in Civilization 5. It lets me build certain ships and stuff like that. And if I look around, do I see any? Yes. Oh, look at that. We already have access to it. So titanium 70 is on this jungle plant right here. We'll start building that right there. And right here. You can queue up stuff much like in Civilization 5 for this game. It's, you know, worth doing sometimes. Nothing pretty much popping up there. He's got, boy, this is going to be an awesome system down here for whoever regrets it. I'm actually tempted to go down and try and grab it, but something I noticed that early on, well, I'm probably going to go to war with this guy just because of his proximity, but as you get closer and closer to our civilizations, they get a little bit, you know, antsy about your borders being so close to theirs, and then, you know, it just sort of gets negative relationships and all that. You know what? Let's just go down and visit the Sylphons. We'll do that. So, go this way. I guess, you know, greet our neighbors. They're the only ones I can see at the moment, but, you know, whatever. Core deposits on a colonized planet, Oshi-1. Now, I don't plan to do this in, like, whenever I do a let's play of this, but if I want to, I could, like, you know, go rename this stuff. I could go home planet. There's my home planet. Home plane, whatever. So there's home plane. Home plane. And then we can call this, Alpha Cent, you know, for Alpha Centauri if we want to. So here's Alpha Centauri 1, Alpha Centauri 2 is, you know, very generic names. It's not like Earth, Mars, or anything like that. It's just, you know, system name Ying, and then Ying 1, Ying 2, depending on the planets. Alright, we got enough money here. If I go into my empire, you'll see that we're drawing a little bit of dust. I can actually move this down a little bit now. We'll go to this way. I could get him very happy. We'll go... put it at 4. We'll go hire a hero now. So we'll hire you, perhaps, since I want you. And then we can assign this hero to systems or fleets. This is where it sort of starts to look like Total War, I guess, and like sort of how you can assign this person to a fleet, and then they're like your war hero that like goes invading, not really in the combat action itself, but sort of as helping your fleet along to destroy your enemies. We'll assign like a governor to a system. So let's see here. I could go with my home planet, or I go to Alpha Centauri. Let's go probably with Alpha Centauri to build up their, you know, this find over here, because it's an awesome find. This is okay over here, but I'm not going to be colonizing this place anytime soon. And I'm going to be able to colonize this as soon as I get the technology, and then this right after it with the technology. Eden Sense and Mercurite. I might actually want to research this up here, because this will let me uncover those luxury resources listed right there. So this is, you know, where you get the luxury resources over in this tree, as you can see. So we'll go with that. And I should note, if I want to, I could also do a quick find type of thing. Like if I put in Xeno and do a locate, I'll get like 10 matches. And I can like locate. There's like Xenobotany. There's Xenology. And it's like Xenosociology. And you can sort of look around this way if you want to. I don't think you can like look at wormhole or anything like that, sadly. And I think it's like stuck on Xeno right at the moment. So if I go, you have to insert like this sort of like sciencey names in order to find them. If you don't go exactly like that, you won't be able to find them, I don't think. So if I put in worm, press enter. Like here is the only thing that's gonna pop up. This is wormhole hyperspace, wormholes near Pessin are linked. It doesn't like show up the Kashmir effect over here, which is the one that lets me unlock space travel via a wormhole. So it's not completely perfect, this search engine. It's pretty good, but not perfect, I find. So it can be useful if you know what you're looking for. Like, you know, science-wise, what, you know, if I put in PEV scale, and I just partial it, it'll find it for me, but it's not perfect in that. It won't, like, go after, I want to find, like, something that lets me just bound around and, like, you know, or let's just put in laser. So, locate, 2 matches. There's more than 2 lasers I can research. Like, here's 1, I think, laser with the HE battery. And then there's like this one over here, synchronized laser. But these are not the only lasers in the game. If I look up in this tree, you'll see pinch guns, which is another laser. Over here, there might be some more lasers. There's more lasers, obviously, but I'm just not finding them at the moment. It all depends on what you're trying to find and all that. So we have our hero. It's worth knowing that my hero takes a little bit of dust to keep around, but they more to make up with it with their abilities. Like 2 upkeep, this will go up by the way as they level up, so let's try and go a few turns and see if they level up for me. And my explorer is going down and down and down and down. Alright, in our turn, we just researched the one that lets me see tundra. So if I go down here, you'll see that colonizable medium tundra. So that's cool. I want to colonize this, you know, fairly quickly, but we'll not be able to do it right away. Basically, we've got to, you know, get these other stuff out of the way, but that's fine. It'll get colonize eventually. You don't have to bring a settler to colonize this planet. You can, as long as you have one person in the system, you can colonize all the planets eventually. You don't have to build like settler units to go do that for you. And I'm building a heavy isotope refinery over here. We're going to want to build a propagator, I think. And I'll note that we have defenders that I can build right away. Nothing really too great about them, don't worry about them. Unless you really need them for like pirates or this early space combat. Alright, there's the one being researched for air plants. That'll be coming soon after. I could actually skip that actually if I want to. I could go like this for now. That might be a very bad idea going in that direction. The air plant, I don't need it until too soon. And then I'll just get the other one for the luxury resources that I'll be needing. And you're just going to take a while to go down that string. Strings are what connects all your planets to and fro. And you'll actually note that all these strings are connected between planets. So you always travel across strings or wormholes until you get a certain technology. I think it's down in, I think, somewhere over here. Where is it? One of these technologies basically lets you transverse the cold vastness of space however you want, basically. It's one of the strings, those is like, you know, let you get to and fro across strings, but there is a technology that lets you go anywhere in the galaxy, so if you wish to, you can get that. Not sure exactly where it is. Not sure how far you have to go, but it's pretty damn far. As you can see, some of the stuff increases your movement speed on Empire. So I guess you can move faster and conquer things and all that. I won't spend too much time looking for this, but I mean, there's lots of stuff you could go look after, basically. Alright, well, maybe I'll find it some other time. We won't worry about that for now. You're getting really close to the Sophon's nearest world over here. And it looks like the Sophon's actually colonized the world over there. So yes, I can actually see what the, you know, what they're doing even if I can't see them, you know, so to speak. So Horatio's colonizing in this direction, Sophon's going in that direction. The Automaton's colonizing you, they got Mizar over here. Really cool thing about the Amoeba is that this is sort of like a vantage. It's really good and useful early on, and it lets you grab all the good plants if they're around you. And like you can, I could go like go down to Lyolka down here if I want to and colonize it before Sophon's could even blink an eye, pretty much. Though I'm not going to do that because it's just like a crappy planet and maybe kind of isolated down there. All right, you bought that. Cool. And you can go here, and I'll send you here. Alright, so first contact, you've encountered Sophon's Empire. When you encounter an Empire, you always start in Cold War, so if you look at that, Cold War neutral. Cold War is basically not peace, but not at war. If I want to, I could like attack this system in Cold War, and this guy wouldn't care. He couldn't do anything about it. He wouldn't like it, but it would, it'd be technically something I could allow. If we're in peace, I couldn't attack it. If we're in war, I can attack this. I can attack. Let's just explain it this way. In war, you can attack anything that the opponent that you're at war with has. In Cold War, you can only attack their colonies, so anything that's not in an influence area. In peace, you can't attack anything. And then the fourth one, Alliance, you're pretty much allied to them, and you're pretty much defending their systems if your ships are anywhere inside their influence. You're now alone, blah, blah, blah. Oh, cool. Our hero leveled up. I'll talk about that in a little bit. Let's go up here to science. I want to get down to wormholes very quickly because it benefits me to do so. I want to basically get this, and I probably want to get that, and there's a lot of stuff I want to get, right? So we'll go. That next. then that, and then that for wormholes. So that'll be my sort of Amoeba battle plan. We want to get the ability to go through wormholes right away on Amoeba, because I know where everyone is, and if I go and like contact them all as Amoeba, I actually get bonuses, because Amoeba are sort of like, let's find everyone and then be at peace with them. And be in harmony, because that's what they're all about. Alright, so I got the technology that lets me analyze and find all this stuff. So I don't have any of that stuff in here, but if I go here, nope. There's a fusion rings. So fusion rings is really cool. That makes this lava plant a little bit more livable. Basically, okay, it doesn't help that much. Some of these stuff will increase your approval rating, which is what, you know, it's like your happiness. But other stuff is going to help your technology and stuff like that. There's more fusion rings. Robot locals. Nope. Antov rings. Cool, but not really the stuff I'm after. There's some dust water. So that will basically increase hero experience per whatever on Empire. I guess that's dust water. And it affects if resource monopoly. Monopolies are something where you have enough of the resources, you get a big bonus from them. That'll happen every so often. He's got some red sang, so there's a bonus for him. I would have thought that there'd be like an approval type thing, but I don't see it, so I won't worry about it too much. Let's go to our hero. So heroes can level up. If I inspect this guy, you'll see that he's level 2 now. And that basically unlocks abilities I can pick. We're going to go right out of the way with Director. And then when I get the chance, I'm going to want to basically pick up Civil Engineer, which increases the production of the plant. So this is where heroes are good. They can increase your production and or like, you know, give these bonuses that help you out as a governor or as a combat fleet type of thing, depending on the, you know, hero you pick. So two of the things I want to get right away is crop geneticist and Civil Engineer will help my production of food, so I can build up my systems faster. Alright, well, there's that. And let's move you, and you've already made to the Sophons. Now, the Sophons could attack me while I'm in their influence, but I can't attack them. And there's nothing wrong with them attacking me inside their influence. That's just, you know, they have the right to defend themselves, and I don't have any right to be in their influence type of area. And they could attack me out here, and there'd be nothing wrong with it. I mean, Cold War is Cold War. You can attack anyone outside your state of influence, basically. Exploration, you know, comes at a price and all that. We're going to leave this guy down here until I get wormhole effects, and then we'll cross that, hopefully. And we're just going to basically, at this point, Alright, I can boost all the way up to Approval of Fervent. Now, I haven't really explained this, but as you increase your tax rate or decrease it, your approval goes up and down. And you get bonuses depending on how high or how low your tax rate is. The lower it is, the less dust you get. So as you can see, I get 85% approval on the system, but it only comes at a cost of 0.3 dust on the system. It's always a boost just like all the way up to, let's see here, 40%, I get much more dust, 0.8, but I only get 50% approval. So your tax rate is a big thing. It depends on like how fast you produce dust or like how much research you get. So if I do this, you'll see my my research per turn goes far down. If I bring it back up, you'll see it go up. And you want to get a good balance of your tax rate, because you can buy out lots of stuff with dust, but you know, you can't research and do that. You know, you can't buy out research and stuff, so there's that. Trade routes and Empire factors, these are, you know, stuff you can look at. Empire, from tax rate, from expansion distribution, from gain difficulty. So as you expand, your, you know, your approval rating goes down. Trade routes, bonus from faction trait. I don't exactly have a trade bonus with anyone yet. Trade routes, that'll appear eventually once I get peace with the Sophons down there or the other guys, depending on what I research. Before you can get trade routes, you basically have to be at peace with them or have a certain trait that lets you trade with them in Cold War. The person who can do that is Pilgrims. They're an Empire. The Pilgrims are basically able to trade with anyone regardless of whether they're Cold War or peace. They just can't trade with anyone in war, basically. And again, I have to go up here to get peace, so boom, there's a piece in the, you know, the long run. We'll want to pick it up. Alright, and I got Xenotourism down here. As you can see, just by looking at all this other stuff, if you look at this, I get, like, you know, the different types of amounts depending on, like, the plants I colonize, so sustainable, this will make it so if I'm on a tundra arid type of plant, these sustainable farms will let me produce more food at a cost of like, you know, negative 2 deaths for the improvement. Xenotourism, that will boost up my, well, per colonized terra and per colonized jungle and all that. Xenotourism basically lets me get more dust depending on what I've colonized. So if I have a jungle, ocean, terran plant, arid, or tundra, I get, you know, money for it. So this will be something I want to pick up, because jungle, tundra, and arid are all going to give money, and I'll get big boosts of dust just from having that improvement in there. If I was to do it here, it wouldn't be as great. I only have, like, the ocean plant here that will get me the bonus to, like, you know, the dust, but it's not too bad. It's still going to be a net gain as long as I produce it. Alright, we're going to probably have to pump through quite a few turns before I really benefit from anything, so let's do that. And I've got Arid Epigenics. So if you go in here, you'll notice I can now colonize the small Arid, and that will give me access to Mercury Light whenever I get it. So if you read the requires containment fields type of things, or requires non-bionic particles, this is what's telling you what you need to get this stuff. So if I want Eden Incense, I have to get non-bionic particles. That should be over here, actually. So yeah, non-bionic particles, and this unlocks the Eden Incense, which will give me the approval from that resource if I get. So there's some resources here to pick up, as well as over here. And you have to look around for all this stuff sometimes, but you know, there's stuff that you can unlock and use, so to speak, that'll help you around. Here's one down here, gems and minerals. I don't think military has any, because, you know, military is sort of about combat. It's not about exploration or helping your empire. Hey, there's a Sylphons that, you know, we're down below. They're now at my home playing plant. So there's their fleet. If I click on him, you'll see that he's got a combat strength. You know, what this all this stuff means. You'll see enemy fleet, because he's, you know, Abra and Cold War at the moment. The sort of radar with the 1.5 next to it, that tells you how many ships are in the fleet and how big his fleet's going to be. So he can only have a fleet of 5 at the most, and he's only got one ship in there. The combat strength is, like, right next to it. That's the fist. Tells you how strong the fleet is for combating other fleets. The one right after it is invasion. That invasion means zero. He can't invade my systems or anything, so all he can do if he you know, tries to invade my system is blockade it, so they can't do anything. The little portrait and the health and all that. Health is for health, obviously. The portrait is for heroes, and the little arrow of the movement, that's his movement, obviously. So he's got 0 out of 11 movement left, and he can't move at all. I'm building a procreator, as you can see from that panel. And you're sort of sitting there being happy. I should note, by the way, there's these stars. I haven't really been going after them, but the stars, like, give you little bonuses when you run into them. It's actually worth getting them, but obviously, unless you go and get those stars, you're not going to benefit from those stars. I guess I can send you. It's going to be a while before I get a chance to get you know, out of here with wormholes. I forgot about that. And we're a little free with this guy now. That's very cool. So we can get this, and that will increase my production. Or I can go with crop genesis. That'll increase my food. We'll get food for now. The hero's actually gaining experience depending on what's getting built, I think. So heroes will gain experience or whatever for, like, you know, tending to a colony, or being on a ship and gaining invasion experience or ship combat experience, all depending on what they do. Killing constructions, blah blah. Move you this way. Alpha Centauri's colonized the tundra. So if I go here, the tundra's now colonized if I want to, and I can just go in here and do this. And if I want to, I can colonize this now. What this means, by the way, is that as colonized means people are now living on this planet. So not only are they living on this jungle, they're also living on this tundra planet over here. And there's all this still just down here if I want to. that'll help me with science, which will be important to get eventually, but we'll worry about building up our plant first. Getting dust is also good too, because well, I don't have a whole lot of dust, and as you can see, it's already gone negative again. Let's go about that far. Your improvements will bring down your dust quite quickly, as well as your upgrading heroes. But, you know, you want to combat that with having the improvements that sort of, you know, help you do whatever you need to. And you're going up there. Much like in Civilization 5, you can, like, you know, sort of just multitask how far to go. And it's sort of better than Civilization 5 in the sort of sense that they don't get lost going, you know, from system to system to system. They will, you know, get there very well, very easily. No real problems with doing it. So he's almost at Pollux, and I suppose for this, if I was to go and just like sort of colonizing type of thing, I want to colonize this plant next, Boisat, because it's got the jungle plant, and this sort of, so you know, sort of blocks off the Sophons from doing anything. This is like too poor to really colonize, so I wouldn't worry about it at all. I might be worried about Lycona over here, but. You know, whatever. I suppose if I get Procure and get down to like, it'd be nice to get that, but it's not, you know, terribly needed that I have to get it. Sophon's just got such nice plants down here. I've only got 4 up here, and then I've got these 2 up here that aren't really that great. This one's just horrible, and I don't think I'd ever touch Pegasus, to be honest. Ying is like pretty good after I get the stuff for it. I'll just look at it this right now. If you go into a plant and you sort of hover over the small desert or whatever plant type it is, you'll see the approval rating, what it offers you. So deserts are good for a bit of dust compared to, say, oceans, which are good for food production. You know, food and science are good in oceans with, you know, just whatever production dust afterwards. Medium lava, they're good for production. They all come with like improvement hits, so like oceans are fine with approval. Deserts, you know, not that great, not that bad, it's just negative 10. Lava, negative 15, that's pretty bad. If I go over here, jungles, they're fine. Tundra, negative 5. Arids, so these, like, you know, this is actually being combated by a metallic water, so this is actually providing a plus approval to me. This will probably, you know, pretty much combat it, so these will be equaled out. If I go to Pollux, and that's all lava. If I go to Ying and like look at the barren plant, negative 15, much like the lava plant. The gas plant is like this crap, negative 20. You never want to colonize this unless it's like a really good anomaly or resource that you want to get. You can colonize asteroids. They're much like barren plants, though they have as you can see, they have good bonuses to everything. So good production, good dust, good science. Heliums will depend, you know, the gas plants will depend on what they are. Helium gives you good a good science boost to it. If I look at the one over here, there's hydrogen. So hydrogen gives you dust boost instead of science. So there's like a little bit of look at the gust and helium and all that. So just to do it again. Helium, good science boost. If we go down here to Columbia, hydrogen, good dust boost. So they're like bad plants to live on, but they give like good bonuses and all that. Here's Arctic, by the way. Good science boost. You get into this game, like, you know, and all that. And it'll like be important. You want to balance your approval with the resources you get, because that's how you advance your empire. If you have poor approval, then you can't really build anything, but if you have like this like one bad plant that has really good resources, it sort of makes up for it. You just don't want to do it too much. Alright, so turn 15, and down you go. Pollux apparently has the Glittering Halls, so that's a wonder. So the Glittering Halls is a wonder. It gives 50% star system, I guess, like production, and 10% control recovery, invasion on star system. So the Glittering Halls are great for production and for just like, you know, preventing invasions. This is also a really good system to have, just because it has really good production plants. This would be where you build ships, And it's got this Terran plant that's, you know, not going to hurt to colonize right away. So you can provide yourself a base, get some, you know, outposts there that'll eventually turn into a home base, and then you can start building from it. I'll go into that right now. If you look at my home plane, you'll see it says home system. So this is the home world of the Empire. If I go down here to Alpha and Centauri, you'll see it says outpost with an 18 next to it. So an outpost has been set up in this system, requiring some time to become a colony. A colony is basically much like, you know, your home system. It has an influence area, and it basically can't be invaded. So that's just how it, like, it sort of works. You put down an outpost, it builds up into a colony, and then Cold War will not allow it to be taken. So this could be attacked by the Sylphons right now, but they're not going to attack it because they're Sylphons and all that. Efficient shielding. Here's the ship class I got, the Adenin. And we're going to go to apply customer effects. That's cool. Alright, I want to demonstrate what this is all about. Each time you get a new type of ship design, you basically have to go in here. And then you can basically do whatever you want to it. So the Adenin. Okay, so you see the effects, these are like the bonuses, like each of these have different bonuses. This one has shield module tonics on the ship so it can protect itself better. This is good for basically colonizing, so it has a colonization support module. This basically has a flak module tonic, so down here you'll see that it's flak. Basically this ship is, you know, good against missiles, so they can't really harm this ship with missiles. The enemy, if they try and attack. Right now, I don't have a lot to sort of invest in these ships, but let's see here. As resources needed. So, as you can see, some of this stuff needs resources to build. This one right here requires time in 70, so that's where this is good for. You can build armor. And armor basically gives you 50% health and defense on defenses. Not a bad thing to have. I could get repair, but I require something for it. Could get better engines, special modules. Pretty much right now, I don't have a lot of military stuff, so I can't really build, you know, show you the full thing about designing your ships, but I can design so, like, you know, my ships could be glass cannons. So there's all the tonics, and I just made it my, you know, 10 connect type attack, and it'll just fire a whole lot of connects, but it won't have any sort of defense. So we don't want that, so go like this. Now it's got 4 deflection, it's got 5 connects, we'll maybe boot this up to 6, or... Okay, so it doesn't really matter what I'm picking here. This is a total tonics, by the way, on your ship. You can only build so much of these modules into your ship before your tonics runs out. You can, as you can see, every time I, like, sort of, like, boosted this up, it sort of affects the stuff over here. So, this is the combat power, this is, like, the health, number of command points required to have a ship in your fleet, so... Bigger ships will require more command to build them. I can't invade anything until I get the proper support modules, so don't worry about that. Accuracy score, so it's got fairly low accuracy because it's using mostly connects, and connects kind of suck. Evasion score and selected ship design, blah blah. Alright, so I'm pretty much happy with this ship. Let's say I want to, like, create it, so this will be like... close combat, that's what we'll call them until I get better stuff. There's also special slots, by the way. This hull of the ship is designed to have a slot available for specialization, and the hull of the ship has a slot available for specialization. That sort of tells you, like, you know, certain things, like if I want to, you know, take advantage of this sort of like 30% flak module tonics on a ship. If I, like, get the technology that lets me get this, I could put, like, 2 extra flak things on here, and they would cost 30% less than what they usually would. So this is, like, sort of an important thing in designing your ships. Certain races have different abilities to their ships, and in the Amoeba's case, they have, like, a defensive type of thing. So there's shield module that makes it better to put on shield modules. That's in the support module, I think. Or maybe it is, you know, it's over here, and these are all your shields. Might be all this, I'm not sure. But I noticed this is flak, that's for this right here. And if I want to, I could put on 2 flak things, modules, and they would be costing less for it. If I was a, you know, say it was like the automatons, they have like repair and armor and stuff like stuff. So armor's down here, and if it's like armor -30, that's where I get it. Anyways, let's just create this. So there's Close Comet. I can build it now if I want to. It'll require 94 production. This is compared to Defender, which takes 80. Kind of better. Requires titanium, but you know, whatever. There's the Explorer over here. That takes 108. Because, I don't know, I guess the engines make it a whole lot more. Certain modules would cost more to build, so there's that. Alright, so the Procreator is made over here. And as you can see, it's right here. You have to create a fleet for him. So there's my propagator. He'll go down here and colonize that for me. And this little dash means there's nothing being produced at my home plane. Now, what would happen is I don't have to, I guess, sort of develop anything. But if I don't, here's what happens. So we'll end the turn. Now, if I go here and I try and build something, it should be, you know, this will usually take 6 turns to build. This takes 5 turns to build now, because what's happened is I've actually built up a little bit of, industry to, like, sort of, like, you know, build stuff. If you, like, wait several turns in, like, trying to build stuff, it'll actually make it quicker for you to build stuff, I think. I'm not sure how much it queues up. I don't think the, I'm not sure if you can queue up. I know the automatons, how they work is they, you want to, like, wait before you build anything on automatons because they can build really well. For your other stuff, there's really no reason to. You almost want to queue up stuff every single time in the other races, basically. Alpha and Centauri's got this colonized, so we'll go here, do that. And we'll go with this after it. Or maybe we'll go with this. By the way, you have this industry, dust conversion, and science conversion. This is like your wealth and like your science type of things in Civilization 5, so you get those right away in this game. My hero leveled up again. If I want to, he could be like a crop genesis, which basically increases production on a planet, basically depending on who's already on it. That'll be good for him because, you know, he's got free plants to build up right away. So I'll build up the plant real fast. Alright, you're gonna go down there, cool. End turn. Now if I go to home plane, and it should, if I go try and build this propagator. Okay, so there it is. It is building up. So I haven't built anything here for a little bit, but I built up the industry and now I'm able to build a propagator faster as a result. The Emperor can't afford to buy this item out. So yes, you can actually buy out stuff depending on what you're trying to build. So if I try and build this, this requires 167 dust. The Explorer requires 240, much like in the original Civilization 5 game. We'll just go with propagator for now. I just sort of mentioned this because if you're ever going to play the automatons, it's very important you understand that you can like save up your industry for it, and it's really important to do so. This is as you can see, there's a hero in this one. So they've got a hero now in their fleet, and you can see your portrait right there, and improves the system near the enemy fleet a little bit, sort of. Not sure what they're going to do there, but well. Pegasus exploration event. So because I got that sort of exploration event, this is what happens. I basically have 20% on system for 5 turns. So these can be good or bad. They're much like the goody huts that you find in Civilization 5. So if I go to Empire and Empire Factories, you'll see that I have 20% from exploration event. So effects in progress on fires from Pegasus, and everyone's going to be basically producing faster because they explore a little bit. Exploration is very important, basically, as you can see. So I didn't really take advantage of it, but it's important to do so if you want to get ahead in this game real quick. So yeah, you're building a propagator. You're going to colonize this plant. Let's see here. I should probably try and colonize this. I'm not sure if it's the greatest idea, but it's probably worth doing. But we'll probably want to contact combat the Sophons before I do anything else. As you can see, they're actually they grab Zark over here. They should probably go grab this sometime soon, but I'm not going to worry about them grabbing that right away. All right. So right now we're researching the applied Kashmir effect. It'll take 7 turns before I get, and then this can come after 4 turns. So it'll take about 11 turns to complete all my research. This will be a long little wait, but whatever. It'll be worth it. So you're gonna keep going down. Alpha and Centauri. They're at my home planet now. Or my colony now. I can't really do anything at this place, so this is where we just start converting stuff. We'll get some science. It might actually be a better idea if I make Alpha Centauri here, produce a ship though. Let's see, we'll go propagator, that'll take 2 turns. If I doesn't want to, I could go here and I could go close combat instead. I think the how it works is the production will queue over to other stuff, much like in the older civilization games and lower difficulties. So if I was producing this propagator, switching over to this won't waste any of the industry to do so. And I'll have my close combat vessel to defend myself if I need to. All right, you're here. There's that jungle. And let's just build this. And I'll build this. And then we'll go what? Doesn't really matter what I'm gonna produce on this one. This is not gonna need to do much of my system to do anything in. This will just be a placeholder system, pretty much. Wasat. That's what I got. Mineral poor, toxic. There is nothing good about this system over here, but it could be good, to sort of pick up as a placeholder if I really need it later on. All right. Onward. All right. Let's just keep going, I guess. Okay, Alpha Centauri built the ship. And reacting to the population of your space, galaxy and speed, which can also expand occurring. They have improved, I guess, a little bit for some reason. Create this. You can go up here and colonize Pollux. And yeah, we'll go back to this convert now, please. Now, I think what happens is, if I'm converting stuff like this, it's only going to convert so much of my production, like as you can see here, 30% of industry converted to science. So after 3 or 4 turns, I'll actually still have some industry to build stuff from this system. So it'll actually only take so much of that industry to science. It's kind of cool in that, I could be just sort of doing like the wealth thing in Civilization 5, and then say I really need something right away, I can start building like a ship or a military unit instantly. Because I have built up industry for it in this game, basically. That's how it works. You'll see what I mean in a bit. So over here we built our close combat vessel. We'll build this over here, I guess. We don't care about this. Well, I suppose we care about it, but whatever. I'm already at full sort of health here and all that. Let's go with this, I guess. This will give me, whatever. Oh, it'll be good. Great. There's a combat fleet right there. There's going to be a purpose for having this combat fleet, you'll see in a moment. As you can see right now, it has basically 130 combat to it. And we'll send him over to here. Home plane, right. You're going here. You're right there. Now, you'll notice that I have a 92 dust over here. Let's say at this point I want to get something else. So we remember from one of these guys is that they got good invasion, and this guy over here has got good defense, offense, and melee. Let's say they pretty much have the same stuff over here, so we're just looking at the stats. This guy's good for invading stuff, and say I want to, you know, we'll go with this guy. As you can see, the dust cost goes up, depending on, like, you know, number of heroes you have. So once I hire this guy, if I want to hire him, he will cost 140. If I go back here to active heroes, this guy, he's just hired. He's got negative 2 upkeep, so he's level 1. That's based on his upkeep. I can assign him to a fleet, and we're going to put him in this fleet right here. So now he's in Fleet Gamma, much like, you know, this person's fleet. That's not him. But anyways, this is the fleet of mine, and he's now in there. He buffers up this fleet a little bit, makes it a little bit stronger. And you'll see him in action in a moment. Alright, so these guys are here. If I want to, I can make these guys fight, but I'm not going to do that. We just want to colonize this place. And we'll go here and say this. And we'll go with this right afterwards. Now, I think that, you know, we saw him go here, but we're going to have you stay right here. You're going to defend this place. You know, basically what this does, by the way, you're currently guiding the star system. Click to stop the interception and potential blockade. So what this is doing is, I basically prevent any fleets from leaving orbit or blockading the star system. So if I do this on this, you see these little things. This means that anyone trying to leave going up in these paths will be attacked by this fleet if they're an enemy to me. And if they try and blockade me, this guy will intercept them and make stop them. There's other stuff here too, like you can like click to explore a galaxy as your explore option. I don't ever do that because it's stupid. It's always better to explore if you're you know, manually. And we got the apply cashmere effect, cool. So if I go down here, you can now cross this place, and you'll see this a little in a bit. Actually, I'll drop you here first, and I'll show you what the wormhole's all about. So, call distant constellations, I can go through the wormholes. Home plane's building that. Over here in Alpha Centauri, if I want to, I could stop this, and I could build a close combat. Take only 2 turns. Just to show you that. Alright, the reaction of population density of a galaxy and your speed which is occurring, or, you know, is degraded. It'll go up and down, depending on what you're doing. If I look at the Sophons here, and I actually click on them. So, diplomatic attitude, 25% due to long-term peaceful status, and infiltrate training is stable, so they're just sort of meh to me at the moment. They sort of like me, but they don't hate me. You know, they don't hate me, they don't like me, they're just neutral. That's like what they are right now, and it's just mostly just sort of long-term peace that we've had. Alright, Wasat's building this now. Okay, so wormholes. Whatever of that. So, wormholes are kind of like, you know, odd in how they work. There's the hero fleet over there, and as you can see, they've actually got a big combat boost now. So, this fleet over here is building up. You got a little bit of defense there. Wormholes are sort of like odd how they work. You'll see that my fleet here has like 3 movement points at the moment. What a wormhole does is you basically don't have like, you know, movement across the string like you do. You just go here and it's like zoomp. And what happened there is this guy used up all his movement points to jump from point A to point B. And what a wormhole does is it takes all your movement points to just move you between the systems. It's kind of cool. And dangerous at the same time, because you can't move in or out of the system if you need to. One bonus of this is that I can go explore out here and get all this stuff now because I've got the wormhole technology. But we're just going to go up to the Horatios, I think. This might be a bad idea, because they could attack me. But we'll see. So, there's another production thing. Yep. Okay, so let's just show you this off now. So in this case, there's this fleet right here. I can attack them, and we'll do that. So this is an investigator, so it's still fine, it's basically a scout. If I want to, I can change how we like do everything in here. So I could go with offensive, sabotage, whatever I want. Let's go with sabotage, which basically gives me negative 50% accuracy on the opponent and increases my long-range weapons, I think. We'll go with offense, and we'll go with engineering. So there's like, you know, three things I'll be doing in the combat. You'll see what it's all about. Let's just go manual here. So we prepare for fights. This is where it's sort of like Rambo's Rome Total War. In Rome Total War, you don't have like, you know, specific units that you build out and send all over the map. You have armies. And this is basically my army against his army. So there's his army right there, his one ship. Mine's warping in. It's right there. So, and then we begin our battle. And there's always three phases of the battle. First is the long range, then is the mid range, and then is the... Alright, he's retreating right away, so he's not going to stick around. But, right now, the battle begins! So there we are, we're firing at him, because, you know, he's not going to fire, he's retreating, but... We're firing at him. There's our victory. So he escapes. So that's like a little picture of what battle's like. It's sort of not really a great one because he sort of ran away, but as you can see, you can sort of defend your systems. Now, if I look out here and check him out, okay, he's not too mad at me, but if you destroy his ships or anything like that, usually they aren't too happy about it because, you know, it's their ships. They don't like you blowing up the ships. You get experience for, you know, your hero being in the fleet of a victory like that, so... There's two levels I got from that, and I can go offensive or defensive on this guy. Let's go defensive, and there's foresight, and I think that's you know, lets you see around your stuff a little bit more. So right now, if I do this, this is like sort of like fog of war type of thing. That's my vision, how far I can see away from myself. So if I do this again, and like do this. He should have more vision, or I guess he doesn't have more vision, but that's like what should happen. He should get more vision from doing that, I guess. Basically, these all do different things, you know, depending on what you're looking at. There's a battle report, so it tells you what happened. Effective damages was 36 health. My Kennec was the only thing I had. His best defense is deflect. And Irish defense efficiency was 92%, so pretty good defense. I didn't really hurt him, he just sort of ran away. That's the sort of effect, you know, you can, you know, probably expect. You can buy better weapons, and I probably should. So let's go up here to military trees. We'll get this and this, so we'll get those both. I'll send my scout up a little bit more. End of turn. Send my scout a little bit more. He got Esther. Discovery will have no effect because you're not here in the fleet. Ah, pirate ship! Alright, so pirates sometimes appear. They really suck. I don't want to be dealing with a pirate, so we'll just retreat. Much like, you know, with the other guy that Sophon did, he retreated. We'll auto it. Auto is pretty much like, you know, what you expect, is just automatically fight the battle, you don't decide anything. Or you don't see anything. He did a little bit of damage, didn't really hurt me too much. Brashia, nice. Don't care. There's the Dust Nebula, it's another wonder. Okay, what happened? Where am I? Okay, so I guess the pirates and Perseus. I can't get up to Perseus that way, so we won't worry about it. I guess we'll go to the automatons over here. So it's that way now. Maybe we'll go to Rigel. Eh, we'll go to the automatons, why not? Alright, so here we go. The radius is now really, really big that I can see. So, because I got that, I can see a whole lot more with my Kiro. I'll actually know it's not too important to do that, but sometimes, you know, if, like, systems are close enough, like, if I might be able to see Lyoka from there. He colonized that finally, I see. Alright, we got those. Very nice. I want to... By the way, this stuff here lets you get more ships in your fleet. So command points, now ships and stuff you can have warping your stuff. Let's get this stuff. Alright. I haven't really been doing anything on my home plane. I can actually build stuff here. This will increase trade routes. That's important to have. Actually, I haven't done this yet, but if I want to, I could go to the Sophons here and say, hey, what's up? Let's have peace. So I can offer peace. Finally, we were wondering how long it was going to take for the blood to circulate above the neck over there. So he's happy about peace. Okay, offer. We're at peace! So we're at peace with these guys. If I go to my empire thing and... let's see here. I should go to this one. You'll see that Renal is peace and he's friendly. So you can get peace out of him. Trade routes will start spawning now between me and the Sophons. Because I see him and he sees me. So, outgoing trade routes list. Zork and Corvos apparently have trade from my home plane. So if I go in, if I go in here, I can go to my home plane and build another trade route. The amount of trade routes you have, I think you only have like two per world. But this will let, you know, stuff like this will let you build them up and you get them more. So yeah, they're right there, trades, two of two. If I go down here to Alpha Centauri, you'll see it's got 0-0. So this guy's got no trade. So if I go down here, do this, that'll be built right away. We'll have trade in this sector. 0-0, we should try and fix that. And Hulk's is still just building stuff, so it doesn't really matter what he's doing. Now, because we're at peace, this guy's list is friendly, and friendly fleets will go through here like nothing. This guy's not trying to block a friendly fleet, he's just trying to block an enemy fleet, so... We'll actually move you down here, I guess. So, go to Alpha Centauri. Don't care about that plant. So, deal's accepted, we're at peace. And special isotopes, cool. Dismiss. The galaxy can explore while they understood. Sophons believes that the balance between these two objectives is not ideal and it's improved. Cool. Very nice. Labor systems of Regulus have been revealed. Very nice. That's kind of cool if you need to have that sort of thing, but whatever. And you're just slowly getting up to. I'm actually tempted to go right to the Horatio, but we'll sort of wait on that. We'll get this one. You're waiting there, cool. Just sort of guard that system, please. Now, I'll note that Alpha Centauri is doing really, really well. All these places have alien grafting, and that's not really too ideal, actually, so we're going to go here and we're going to start changing this stuff around. I have a jungle, I have a tundra, and I have arid, and I probably want to change this to something more befitting this system. So I can make this, like, you know, let's put it this way. He's got okay science, pretty good dust, pretty good dust, pretty good dust. Maybe we'll go on, you know, try and make a dust type of system out of this. So we'll go in here. I'm going to just build Colonial Exchange, which is basically a dust type of exploitation. It'll increase the dust, basically, for these plants. Because we don't need, you know, population when we're so full of it, so get that. The system doesn't really benefit my hero either, so what I'm going to do too, let's say Pollux. Pollux is a pretty good place. Let's have my hero come here instead. So now my hero will go be assigned to this system, and he'll start improving this system instead of like the one down here. 7 turn sources and outposts, cool. Another thing to note, I picked up a few military technologies. So let's just look back in here. Let's say I want to change or add. I could actually upgrade this to do something else. Yeah, let's do that, why not? We'll upgrade this ship a little bit. So I can modify this guy to do a little bit, you know, different stuff now. He's got the armor stuff, and he's got the power, and he's in power. He's just got armor. I can, however, change the other stuff here. So remember I said I can increase this twice? So I can put one flak in there. We'll drop this down a little bit. Drop those down to this a little bit. So I can put two flak here easily enough, and it barely takes anything to put this stuff on, because this guy's designed to have flak modules on him. I can also put missiles on him. There's a couple missiles. And I don't need that many missiles, so just put one missile. Put a beam on him. Put a shield on him. And there we go. There's my new close combat type of guy. He's got some good, you know, he's got a little bit of flak. Not so much medium, but he's got fairly good other stuff. I can actually do this if I want to. Now he's got pretty even stuff. Probably not the greatest way, but whatever. And, you know, I can keep adding this stuff on all I want, but whatever. You probably don't need this stuff to begin with in the early game, because no one has the stuff to sort of fire at you. Yeah, we'll go with that. That looks fine. Alright, so apply. I can all upgrade if I want to, so click this button to automatically upgrade your modules to the latest version. So, I'll upgrade. If I have, like, a module that's better than, like, what's being listed here, then they'll be pushed up to the top. I don't have anything that's better than, like, say, the level 1 kinetic, but eventually you'll have, like, 2 beam, 3 beam, 4 beam, and all that, and you won't have your best stuff, you know, usually to keep going on. So there's that. If I wanted to, I could make a new ship with the, you know, a Dino class. I can make it so, like, instead of having kinetics, I have, like, 1 kinetic, a little bit of deflect, 3 beam, that much, this much. Actually, let's just reduce a little bit, put this on. And you'll see, like, all the sizes down here too, right? So there's 4, there's 6, and all that. Deflect. So there we go, there's a new ship. It's got 1 kinetic, it's got 3 beam, it's got 2 missiles. This is, like, you know, like, sort of like a long-range, medium-range type of guy. So we'll call this guy mid-range. I'll note, by the way, that when you're building ships like this, I forgot to do with the other one, but you can go like medium range, change the effective range of your module. So that's made for, like, you know, medium range. This is like long range. This over here is like short range, so Lee. This will actually change the tonnage of the stuff, so they're actually less. That's something you should do if you're going to, like, put lots of missiles and stuff or whatever, because it'll actually change the tonnage. Let's do this again. And I probably want to put on what? Actually, let's just drop that down. I don't need that. That gives me that much. Extra missiles. There we go. Well, now it's not really mid-range. So let's call this non-melee. Very, very, very descriptive, isn't it? So it's non-melee. If I like a close combat 2, by the way, it's called, like, close combat 2. If I just like to, like, go out here on my screen, this guy's still close combat 1. So, just a note, these guys don't upgrade as you build them. And just to, like, upgrade that as well. If I go into here and manage this guy, and, like, you know, I can modify him again, we're just going to change this stuff, so, you know, melee. And medium range. So that, you know, makes a little bit more space in my ship so I can do stuff. If I got 3, 2, 1, I probably want more deflect, so we'll do that. And there we go. That's just like a little bit of change. Close combat 3 is now a go, and there he is. You can see like what they've got. So close combat 3, he's got 3 deflect, he's got this kinetic and all that. You can see all of this is here. And if I try and build these stuff too, you'll see that the old Close Combat 1 and 2 are gone because they've been upgraded to Close Combat 3 and Amelie over here too. And they both require Titanium to build. So I need them. Those are my ships. I have them. Cool. Okay, here's a sort of like, you know, you can have multiple things. One technology random discovered. 10% space on Empire, or 50% on Empire. So here's like, you know, sort of like a thing. I can have like a long-term type of thing, a short-term type of thing, or immediate type of thing. I could, you know, randomly discover something. Let's just do this. So there we go. I randomly discovered something. And that random discovery is whatever, I guess it'll be next turn. Home plane has developed something, Pulx has developed something. Let's go here and build the this. And we'll go this. And we'll go that. And why not? We'll build a close combat anomaly. That'll take a little bit, but whatever. I haven't really looked at it, but if you look at my home plane, it's now got free trade routes, and they're going to Zark, Lahat, and Lacona. If I look at Alpha Centauri, it's got one of one. It's go to Corvos, blah, blah. I mean, I could go to my Empire screen and go to trade routes, and it'll show all the outgoing trade routes. These guys could have incoming trade routes, by the way. Actually, we do. So the Sofons actually have two trade routes coming into me, so they're actually benefiting a little bit from our pack. If I go to Empire Factors, by the way, I'm actually getting 4 approval of faction trait just from being at peace with the Sofons. So this is actually because of being at peace with the Sofons. Another reason I went for peace right away. You know, we're isolationists and we like to go to peace with people. As Amoeba. That's not too good. Gonna be in a fight again. The thing about retreat is that it always sends you backwards, sadly, so not that great. Oh, let's keep going. I'm trying to get this to be a colony before we end this. One technology randomly discovered. That's just because, you know, the last thing. And whoa! A new colony ship is created on Mikrish. Interesting, I actually got a colony ship here. And I could actually colonize this right away. Cool. It'll probably do me good, I guess, to start colonizing to get this right away. I can't move them anywhere easily, so. Colonize that. Now, the pirate over there could attack me, but I'm not too worried about it. I mean, if he attacks, whatever. Each of these planets is sort of independent how to contribute to your overall empire. So if this like gets attacked out of here, it'll hurt its approval on this planet, but it won't, you know, it'll hurt my overall other planets in my system sort of. So it's all, you know, it's all good pretty much. Get this. Get that. It'll just keep going. And we got the thing over here, I guess, from yeah, so this is relativistic markets. That's my random discovery. It's over here, somewhere. There it is. So relativistic markets. This gives me open borders. I can trade dust. All this other stuff they can do in like sort of diplomatic sort of type of stuff. They can inspect of, you know, in civilization. You know, you have to sort of like, you know, research the stuff to get. All right, we can go in here. I can go build a couple of things. I would note that this is a stealth star system improvement over here. This thing is like a defensive thing. It's listed as red. I'm not building it because, you know, I don't really defense from the Sofons because I'm at peace with them at the moment. I trust the Sofons will be nice to me. So we'll build up a little bit more. And we got Iz. And we found the automatons, and they are going to kill me. Because, you know, they're so defensive. So, we want to flee from these guys and auto it, and hopefully I won't get killed by them. I lost him. He blew up my ship. Ooh, this guy's got beam already. That's interesting. So, lost it to the automatons over here. He's got defenses in Electra. But we did define him, so I can talk to him if I want to. So he's right here, neutral. Evolution trend stable. If I want to, I could offer peace, but we have to, you know this guy a little bit before we can offer peace. As you can see from this guy down here, he's starting to get, he's got this like a negative arrow. So due to score, this guy's actually got a negative 2 liking me for it. As you can see there, he's got positives for a lot of other stuff, but whatever. That negative is something to take care about. Let's see here. Still building. Let's just create this guy. You can merge fleets. So we'll go here. Select all. Merge. Now they're one big happy fleet. I got close combat and non-melee. So nice little mix of, you know, sort of defenses there. Core mining. I haven't really noticed it yet, but some of the stuff is orange. Most of the stuff that's listed as orange, is basically stuff that you can only pick up as this faction. So I can't like trade or do anything with this certain technologies because this is an Amoeba technology, it says right there. And I actually need to research it myself to get it. You can't trade the Sophons for or anything like that. Certain stuff like the ships are orange because each empire has sort of different ships. You have to research your own ships. Let's get this next and this next. And this. That's the colonized Arctic. That's an engine type of thing, gives me movement. This one over here is desert. Interesting. That's what you need for diplomatic victory, I guess. We'll get this stuff then. And we'll get this right after. And this. Hyperion was identified, so I can start building stuff by Hyperion if I need it. Hyperion exploitation. Core mining. Wasat now has a bit of trade. Do this on him. I need 4 turns, so we'll just try and breeze through these turns real quick so you can see what that's all about. Your faction only, a rip in fabric. Sometimes, you know, you have these galactic events that hit your faction. Anomaly is randomly created on 4 planets. Ouch! Oh, look at this. We have friendly locals now here. So this is new stuff. And got Entef Ring, so we had some good stuff up here apparently on our stuff, on our plants. And automatons have unable to accumulate dust and need to find additional source of revenue. They notice the inflation of automatons have improved. So these guys are having trouble getting dust and they want to, you know, get dust from us possibly. Do a score, blah blah. Let's offer him peace. So blah blah. I could actually try and grab stuff from him, by the way, so I can do get this. Peace can be offered when it's not intended. And I can actually offer him dust if I want to, so I give him a flat fee. I'm trying, you know, there we go. He's getting really happy about it, so he likes it when he gets a little bit of dust. But we don't really care about that. Let's offer him this, and this, and this, and this, and this, and this. And some dust. What will it take to make you... Alright, there we go. So, Tomo can be better applied themselves to important matters when the galaxy has peace. So, it'll take me all my dust and all this stuff to get that if I want to. Scampirion, stuff like that I can trade. We don't really care about all this other stuff, but let's do this. Offer him peace. I'm at peace with him. If I go to my Empire screen, Empire factors, 8 from faction traits, because, you know, we're now happy with the automatons. I'm going to trade routes. Partner automaton, so bunch of my systems are now trading with the automatons. And Thomas and I are training, you know, no, not training me at all. You can't, you actually have to find a system to trade with, by the way. I haven't stated that, but look at that, 100% approval, pretty much. Well, fervent, pretty much. They're almost, you know, almost ecstatic to have me around. So I can increase this a little bit. I don't really need that, that high, pretty much. I should note, by the way, you get new heroes every so often, so next hero in 24 turns, you can increase the amount of heroes you have around. Now we're at peace. Pollux is now pretty much content. They're pretty much colonized completely too, so let's get this to be production, because this will be production plant. Over here in Wasat, I can change you to be interesting dust. This will never be a really important plant, so let's just make this research, I guess. And we'll change you to be, this is like dust. So we'll change you to be a dust type of plant too. And do that. Create you. Send you down here. Now I shouldn't be too non-careful about these Sophons. They could always declare war on me. So usually the factions that are really close to you have a good tendency to go to war with you if, like, you know, they feel like they want your territory. The Sophons might be nice to me because they're, you know, their AI is supposed to be more of like isolationist, and we want to sort of get our science, but it's no guarantee they will stay that way. All right, keep going. Black defense, anomaly randomly created on one plant, so quantum cult disaster. That's not good. And where does that disaster occur? Is it Pollux? Oh, long scissing. So there's the disaster. This Terran is now hurting a little bit. Alright, Tomtons, bleed, bounce an ideal, blah blah. Research a little bit, cool. Alpha Centauri, very nice. So, clonal exchanges all over the place. I'll obviously keep producing dust in this system, I guess, if I want to, but let's just build anomalies. You can queue up quite a few ships, by the way, and you could actually possibly be able to build them all at once sometimes as well. So, want to merge these fleets. I'm building more than 5, by the way, but it's also worth knowing that once I get this one, I'll get free command points that lets me put those 3 into action easily enough. So I got like one thing right here, I've got 4 down here, and that will equal, you know, 2 plus 3 equals maximum amount of command points for this fleet. So that's something, you know, how to build it. Or actually, I don't want that many because there's one coming, isn't it? Get rid of that then. I only want one fleet at the moment, basically. Now, these do actually take money to keep around, much like in, you know, the original Civilization V again. If I go to dust here, you'll say from fleets, negative 12, and from systems, negative 37. But make a lot of dust, so it's all fine. I'm actually kind of liking this game, but we'll, you know, probably say this is enough showing off at this point. I'll try and get this to be a colony. It's not yet a colony. It's going to be a colony in the next turn. Dismiss. Go here. Select all. Merge. And I'll notice that the combat's going up and it's like crazy. And there we go, we got a colony from Alpha Centauri. So we get a nice big influence, same as our home planet. If I go over to it, it'll say colony. This is a well-established colony on the star system. They'll get colonies down here too eventually. It might be a little bit, might be, you know, quick, we'll see. This is pretty much enough of a showcase of what this game's all about. I hope to probably do a Let's Play. I'm actually thinking about doing a Let's Learn for this series as well, because it seems that it's a little bit lacking in how to play this game. And this guy actually colonized Columbia. Amazing. Alright, well, hope you've enjoyed. This is a 4X game. you'll probably be seeing in the future. I'll be doing other Let's Plays of the other series I have at the moment, but we'll get to it eventually. Hope you've enjoyed. Actually, I'll do a quick little thing about it. This game, blah blah, kind of like Civilization 5, how you like that sort of end screen. This game, you know, it's going to take a lot to you know, cover and how the game actually works, but it's very much similar to Civilization 5 and how, like, you know, have this sort of like early game where, you know, like, you may go to war with like one guy and then later on you'll go with war with the galaxy, pretty much. Very Civilization based and sort of like, you know, sort of like combat war type based game. Not like Total War where like you're always at war with something. The game also has, you know, very interesting research in how you're going with like four tech trees instead of one. And it makes for a very different type of gameplay when, you know, all your military is like this way. You're not like researching a couple nice improvements on the way. You have to backtrack to get a research tree when you need those. And it's going to take a while to play this game. I mean, that's just 30 turns or so from that game right there. I'm playing like the automatons right now. It's taking forever to play them. I like only got like 60 or 70 turns on them. Oh well, I think this is David Fuchsia. I've gone on about this game long enough. Hope you've enjoyed, and you should actually consider playing this game if you like this type of, you know, 4X type of gameplay. Take care.